The four Sundays leading up to Christmas, in the Christian calendar, it is regarded as what we call the Advent Sundays. And the Advent Sundays simply means expectation. Each of these Sundays is represented by a theme. Consequences? Oh, geez. And so this Sunday, I am speaking on the second theme of the Advent Sunday. And the theme for the second Advent Sunday is preparation. Preparation can mean so many different things to so many different people. Preparation for what? Let us read the scripture. Our scripture is from Isaiah 35, and I'm reading the 10 verses in that chapter. The desert and the parched land will be glad. The wilderness will rejoice and blossom like the crocus. It will burst into bloom. It will rejoice greatly and shout for joy. The glory of Lebanon will be given to its will be given to it. The splendor of Carmel and Sharon, they will see the glory of the Lord. The splendor of our God, strengthen the feeble hands, steady the knees that give way. Say to those who are fearful, be strong and do not fear. Your God will come. He will come with vengeance and divine retribution. He will come and save you. Then will the eyes of the blind be opened and the ears of the deaf unstopped. Then will the lame leap like a deer and the mute tongue shout for joy. Water will gush from the wilderness and streams in the desert. The burning sand will become a pool, the thirsty ground bubbling spring. In the haunts where jackal once lay, grass and reeds and cypress will grow. And a highway will be there. It will be called the way of holiness. The unclean will not journey on it. It will be for those who walk in that way. Wicked fools will not go about on it. No lion will be there, nor will any ferocious beast get up on it. They will not be found there, but only the redeemed will be there. And the ransom of the Lord will return. They will enter Zion with singing. Everlasting joy will crown their heads. Gladness and joy will overtake them, and sorrow and singing will flee away. Amen. May the Lord bless the reading of His word. Can you pray with me? Gracious God, we come with expectation. We not only come with expectation, but we come with a heart willing to be prepared for the purpose which You have destined us for. In this season of expectation, God, prepare us to be the bride of Christ. Prepare us to be the sons and daughters of God that is waiting to be revealed to a dying world. Prepare us to stand firm with the belt of righteousness, the belt of truth, and the shield of righteousness, declaring the gospel of peace. We're confident in Your ability to do greater than we can ever think or imagine, because we ask all this through the name of our Savior Jesus Christ. Amen. The season of Advent brings preparation to the forefront, preparing for the arrival of the Messiah, preparing for the birth of Jesus, which was prophesied by the prophet Isaiah about 700 years before Christ. And this season, from the passage of scripture we read, we found out that God had already given a glimpse of a hope of a future promise to a nation that is in slavery. That God was saying through the prophet Isaiah, the time is coming where the lion and the lamb will dwell together. That the time is coming when the parched land, the desert that is considered dead and dry, will become well and spring of living water. And at that point, the Israelite had no clue. It's like they hear the story and it's like, what is this crazy prophet saying? Where is he getting this vision from? Could he probably have been drunk on some things? Or what has he been on, some LSD? But the prophet Isaiah was prophesying the coming of the Messiah. I read this story from The Bread of Life. Several centuries ago, a Japanese emperor commissioned an artist to paint a bird. A number of months have passed by. Then several years, still no painting has been done. Finally, the emperor became so restless and he became so tired of waiting for this painting that he has asked this artist to paint for him. He stormed into the artist's home and he said, I want to know why my painting has not been done. And the artist took out his canvas. In less than an hour, he painted the magnificent bird that has become one of those major world collection. And the emperor said, why haven't you done it in all these years? And the artist turned around and brought out paintings of birds' wings, of birds' head, of birds' feet, of the different parts of the birds. And he turned around and said to the emperor, I have been studying and getting ready for this day. When we read in scripture about the coming of the Messiah, when we hear in scripture as the prophet has promised us, the tendency is for us to expect, oh, we will do it just once and for all. He, just like this artist, God and scripture is calling us to get ready every single day of our life, to get ready in preparing, like the painting drawing the wings, like the painting drawing the feet. And all of this is God is preparing us, is calling us into a deeper preparation that we get rid of stuff in our lives that tend to hinder us from accomplishing and hearing the purposes of God. In the process of preparation, as we get ready for the coming of the Messiah, as we get ready to celebrate the birth of the Messiah, what is that area of your life that you still are wrestling with getting that area ready for the Lord? The artist and the emperor were wondering. The emperor is like, I'm done. I need my painting right here today. Explain to me. In less than an hour, he got it. Can you imagine if the Messiah shows up? You know, I am a little bit skeptical about those that think that once the Messiah showed up, it's poof, he'll take them away. I don't know where we got that theology from. Kind of an exit theology that we just want to check out of this place. This world is going to be doomed anyway. So all we're doing is we're waiting for the Messiah to come and take us home. What about if the Messiah is calling us? Can you imagine? Have you ever thought about the Messiah calling us to be a light, a beacon of hope in this dark world? Have you ever imagined that in the process of waiting for the Messiah, he is preparing us and getting us ready like the bride? Verse 1 to 3 in our reading says, the preparation gave a hope that says, the desert will be parched land. The desert and the parched land will be glad. The wilderness will rejoice and blossom like the carcass. It will burst into bloom. What that means is the desert in your life, The challenges and the cares of life that is holding you back, what seem as if it is the most impossible thing, what seem as if it is the most, it is the greatest mountain that you are wrestling to climb, all of a sudden, when the Messiah, when you allow the Messiah in, it bursts into bloom. It says again, it will rejoice and burst into bloom. It will rejoice and shout of joy because the glory of Lebanon is when given its own splendor. What the prophet is simply saying is the story of the restoration of all things. The prophet is saying and reminding us through the scripture today, this morning, and saying, as you get ready for the return of the Messiah, as you get prepared to celebrate Christmas, it is not talking about preparing just for that family feast. Are you prepared in your heart for the Messiah to burst in your life? Am I prepared in my own life to allow the Messiah to bust in my life? How can the preparation happen? You might be asking. So what? Wait a minute, Pastor. I'm waiting for Christmas. I'm waiting for that big meal. The first area of preparation is getting in touch with yourself. And what I mean by getting in touch with yourself, I'm not talking about, oh, let's go to some shrink or some psychologist and tell you who you are. No, but it's to get into yourself by saying to Jesus, God, where am I in the grand scheme of things in my relationship with you? Holy Spirit, how available am I to hear you every day? And I'm not talking about, I'll hear you on Sunday when I come to church, but on Monday, how can I hear you on Monday? How can I hear you on Tuesday? How can I hear you on Wednesday? By getting in touch with the real you that God has created, because God wants to speak to you and God wants to commune with you. He wants to restore, but in restoring, He prepares. Yesterday, Ella Bo was supposed to go for a painting. We signed her up for some art painting, just art club. It's a group of kids from Washington Academy. But she couldn't go because she was having a fever. So instead of that, I took her to the store and to go buy her own canvas, a little canvas, about 4x4. A little canvas, slightly bigger than this. And I said to her, before you paint on this canvas, well, I'm not just going to hand you a canvas and start painting, but you have to prepare the canvas. Even though the canvas is already kind of like painted and gotten ready, but you don't just imagine what you're going to draw, because we're not drawing a landscape painting. If it's a landscape painting, sometimes you don't need, you can just, the artist, a professional artist, will just get on and start painting. So, but for her, I said, let us work at preparing this, because we're trying to draw a snowman. And if we're drawing a snowman, we need a stencil of a snowman, and so that we can prepare the canvas, draw the kind of trace the snowman around the canvas, so that when we paint it, the snowman will stand out of that. But it takes preparation. It takes getting in touch with you, with what God is stirring. It takes the creativity that God has put in you to get you ready, so that you can hear Him. I've heard people say to me, you know, it's really busy, and I don't even have time to remember all the details of life. And I say, really? I'm not asking you for the details of life. I'm talking about what is God saying to you personally. Oh, I get it in church. When I go to church on Sunday, I hear what God is saying to me. And I said, no, it goes beyond that. How are you communing with God? Are you tuned in to God? How connected are you with the Holy Spirit that you are able to hear when God speaks to you? Because unless you are so connected to the Holy Spirit, every wind of doctrine will be a word of the Lord. Every single preacher, every single sermon you hear will be like the word of the Lord. Let me say to your friends, There are so many preachers out there. So many. I will not mention names. But it's for you to allow the Holy Spirit to help you discern who is truth. Because the Holy Spirit speaks to you and confirms what is truth. I might tell you this is truth. But if you only take it from me without that Holy Spirit's witness, I question your willingness to really dial into yourself, into getting yourself ready for what the Lord is stirring. Our reading showed this morning how Israel prayed about an expectation of hope. Our reading this morning shows us how the prophet Isaiah said to the Israelites, there is hope at the end of this tunnel. There is light. He could paint a picture of showing them the glimmer that the Messiah is going to be born. And he says, when the Messiah is born, the desert that is a parched land will become a fountain, will become a place that is filled up with vegetations. Oh, friends, if there is nothing. If I look at the state of the world today, I tell you, if I go by the American dream, it is a dead end street. The American dream that we all think that we all grew up, we all born, all every one of us want to attend that dream, it's a dead end street. But there's a one street that I am confident of, and that is the highway of the Holy Spirit. That, it's, scripture makes it loud and clear. I struggle when people say to me, I'm an atheist. I don't believe in God. The truth is, there is no single person that will claim being an atheist. Why? Because they know in the depth of their heart. Even the wise man, the Ecclesiastes says, a fool says in his heart there is no God. But that doesn't mean there is no God, because he said so. So in preparing yourself, the prophet Isaiah is saying, as you prepare, strengthen the hand that are feeble. Because God, when you rely on God and rely on the Holy Spirit, guess what? As you trust Him to lead you in all the ways that He is calling you to in this season, it's not about, oh, how much gift am I going to get, or about how much gift am I going to give. I mean, it is okay to give gift. I'm not against giving gift or receiving gift. But I'm saying there is a greater gift that is out there that the Lord has given. Have you received that gift personally? Because the greatest gift that any man can ever give you is the gift of eternal life. And that is through Christ Jesus our Lord. I might give you the key to my car. It might sound like, whoa, finally you get to drive a Ford Explorer. But I tell you, 2-3 years from now, the Ford Explorer will be obsolete. The engine will pack up. The transmission will go off. But when I give you the gift of Jesus, though the world might take your life away, they might not take that Jesus from you. A couple of weeks back, I don't know if you know this man, the man by the name Dan Arnolds. Dan Arnolds was a philanthropist. Oh, let me use the secular word philanthropist. But Dan Arnolds was a man that took $5,000 and turned it into $multi-million. Dan Arnolds is the founder of Road Ranger Gas Station. Every single Road Ranger gas station, he founded it with a $5,000 after college. Dan Arnolds has spent the whole of his life and his resources donating his money. When I first came to Rockford, I ran into Dan Arnolds in one of my, when I used to run the Friday Night Cafe. And after one of our music night, he walked up to me and said, and handed me his card. I had no clue who this man was. It was in the summer, he was in his shorts. And he's been in, this was at Katie's Cafe. He's been hanging out, drinking coffee and talking to everyone. And he said, if you ever need anything, if I can help. Not long after that, I heard the same story of Dan Arnold's when the earthquake happened in Haiti. The same Dan Arnold's flew his private jet to Santo Domingo Island because folks from Heartland were already in outreach in Haiti and flew them back home to Rockford for free. This same Dan Arnold's, the guy that will go, that hung out with the likes of Reinhard Bonnke. He's traveled all over the world, has preached the gospel to thousands, if not millions. But I tell you, when you see this man on the streets of Rockford, you will not know. A few weeks ago, he passed away, and his funeral service was this Wednesday. Reinhard Bonnke was in town, and every single person, if they were to allow everybody that was at the funeral to say how much his life has been impacted spiritually by this one man, I think the service will still be going on. And I want to ask you this morning, one thing I can say for a fact, in my experience with Dan Arnold, he's a man that hears God. He has a connection. That's a real man in our society here that we can see. And God wants that for you. As we wrap up this morning, Brian, do you still have something to share? If you do, I will invite you to be attentive, be in tune to what God is saying.
First of all, it's just take a moment and just wait on the Lord. Jesus, we just come before you this morning and just ask that your presence would manifest itself among us. That your will would be accomplished, Lord, and to touch those individuals that you're already working on at this moment. The other day when I was going to work, I was just playing this song that I'm going to play. And at the time, the Lord was, let's just say he was blessing me during the song. And started as just to bring up a few things, so I knew it was something that wasn't just for me, but that it was for some individuals here. Now, he didn't show me who, but here's where we trust the Spirit that he's at work. But I know that there's individuals who are at a blockade. There's individuals who have such a crust around them, the Lord has trouble getting through. There's individuals who need to go to the next level, but maybe they're afraid. Maybe they don't know how. But the thing is, you know, we all have issues in our life that keep us back from maybe going to the next step. And I'm not sure where you're at today, but we're just going to trust that the Spirit is working on you at this moment. And I'm just going to play the song. And if the Spirit is on you, if God is dealing with you, on something, then the altar is open for you to come up before him and just ask for his help. That's all as simple as it is. God is here that he wants to touch you. Now, I'm sure all of us could come forward because we all obviously have issues, because obviously none of us are there yet. But I know that the Lord will touch you. He'll prompt you. He'll put it in your spirit that it's for you. So if God is working on you, then we're just going to leave it open. And if you feel like coming up during the song, then just come forward.